by the night when it covers it.
Assalamu alaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Welcome back. You're watching Quran and Science. And the topic of this episode is the alternation of day and night. And as the verse said, وَالنَّهَارِ إِذَا جَلَّهَا وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَغْشَهَا. I'd like to first to ask my dear guests their opinion and the meaning that they're getting behind this verse. So I'll start first by Abdurrahman.
I understand from this verse that Allah is telling us that the sun itself is not appearing or disappearing, but it is the day that shows us the sun, and it is the night that conceals it. This is what I understand from it.
Okay, and what, as a human, are you benefiting from this alternation of day and night?
In the day, people go to work and start their lives, and in the night, one has to rest. And
have you tried before to work at night, maybe, and sleep in the morning? Did you have this experience before?
Of course, I had this experience many times professionally. You know, in my profession, I have to work sometimes late, and I always find it very difficult to work in the
it
night.
It makes you feel against the.
I feel like I'm defying the laws of nature.
Creator's law. Yeah. Okay.
To me, I think it's still a continuation of the oath that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving. Still, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is grabbing our attentions as Muslims to His creation, to His greatness through His creation. And also an invitation to study all these phenomena. Yes. And maybe to show to the world and just tell them, this is what Allah says, you know, a long time ago. And this is, we knew about it long before people start to discover things with the modern science.
Moving to Dr. Zaghloul, we need to know your opinion and explanation of this verse.
I begin by thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and praising His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and by greeting you all in our Islamic way. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This second verse in Surah Shams is again a direct indication to a scientific fact that was not revealed to anybody until the days of science and technology of our time. Allah says, وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا, and when the moon would follow the sun. And one would imagine, yani, what's in that? We all know that the moon follows the sun. You see, once the sun sets, the night comes and the moon rises, you see. Yes. But it is an indication to the direct precision of the movement of these two heavenly bodies. Allah has given the sun its own orbit, and has given the moon its own orbit, and has given the earth its own orbit. And amazingly enough, everything in that universe is moving in more than one direction. You see, the earth alone has got 9 main movements, you see. And what not many people know is that the movement is a spiral. It's not in a plane. It's a spiral movement, you see. The moon is moving around the earth in a spiral. And yes, the moon and earth are moving around the sun in a spire.
And this is why sometimes you would find the earth in between the sun and the
yes,
moon.
Yes, I'm coming to that. Yes, yeah. I'm coming to that. And really, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is directing our attention to a very important thing, that the day starts by sunset, and the night precedes the day. And that's why In English, I can't find a proper word for an-nahar, for example, other than the daylight. You see, so we have an-nahar wal-yawm, which is different from the English. They use day for both of them. You see, okay. So in Islam, the day starts by sunset and finishes at dawn time, and these are two cosmic phenomena. Setting the sun is a cosmic phenomenon, which you can define precisely by the setting of the disk of the sun itself. And we have several twilights that come later on. We have the red twilight coming as a sign for Isha prayer. We have the yellow and the orange twilight, the area in between Maghrib prayer and Isha prayer, you see. We have again the red twilight, which is an indication of the true Fajr. So we have cosmic phenomena that can delimit and can divide the day in night and daylight. So When Allah says, وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا, it's directing our attention to this importance that your day starts by sunset. It does not start at midday as it's commonly used in the word today. Midday is truly a cosmic sign, but it is a local cosmic sign. You see, it's not a universal cosmic sign. But of course, once I see the twilight of the sunset or the twilight of the Fajr time, these are fixed boundaries, which I can use very precisely. Secondly, the fact that the moon follows the sun, immediately as the birth of the moon comes into being, a new month, a new lunar month has started. And as you were trying to say, if the moon is between the earth and the sun, the lit part of the moon is facing the sun,
yes,
and the dark face of the moon is facing the earth. And we call this an eclipse of the moon. And once the moon moves out of this straight position, you see, a thin layer of illuminated arch starts on one of its peripheries. So the lunar month is born, and this is a sign of the beginning of a new month, lunar month. And that's why this happens exactly at sunset. If it happens during midday or during daylight, the month did not start. If it happened at midnight, the month did not start. Because Allah has limited the beginning of the month with a new day. And this new day starts by sunset. Yes. So when it says, وَالْقَمَرِ إِذَا تَلَاهَا, means when the moon is born exactly after sunset, a new month has started. A new lunar phase has started. And then, of course, we pass from the crescent, the newly born crescent, to the first quarter, to the full moon, the second quarter, the dying crescent, until we get into eclipse. So the process of eclipsing and the successive phases of the moon can precisely define the moment of the birth of the moon. If I yes. calculated it wrongly, I can correct it by the first correct. Quarter, by the full moon, by the second quarter, or by the dying moon. And these are some of the meanings we can get out of the verse.
And is there any religious indication that having the night starting first in Islam?
Of course, the Quran repeatedly mentions this, that the night starts, the day starts by the night. And on many verses, mm-hmm. the day starts by the night, and the dawn is the beginning of the daylight. And
so maybe would that indicate like ibadah may start more at the night?
That's why you see, as I said earlier, if the moon is born, say at noontime, the new month don't start.
Yes.
You see, I will not for Ramadan, for example, mm-hmm. I will not fast. Because the day did not begin, you mm-hmm. see.
Yes.
If the moon was born at midnight, then the month did not start, not begin. So really the Quran uses these cosmic phenomena of the sun and the moon as ways of dividing time, as a universal clock by which we can define time and we can estimate time.
And in the ayah and the verse, it says, وَنْهَارْ إِذَا جَلَّهَا.
Yes.
What is the meaning of جَلَّهَا?
This is, again, a miracle, a scientific miracle in the Quran. وَنْهَارِ إِذَا جَلَّهَا, when the daylight will make the sun exposed to the eyesight of human beings. And this is strange, because everybody have the feeling that it is the sun that illuminates the daytime. How can the daytime becomes the way of exposing the sun for us? Only very, very recently we came to realize that the sun in its position cannot be really seen properly. What exposes the sun to us is the thin layer of atmosphere, which is not more than 200 kilometers thick. This layer, you find the bulk of the atmosphere is condensed in it. You find plenty of dust particles, plenty of moisture, water moisture, plenty of gas molecules. And when the sun rays come in, fragmented into its various wavelengths, you see. It cannot be seen.
Yes.
So the multiple reflection and refraction of these rays can join them together to produce this beautiful white light of the day. And once you see this beautiful white light, you can see the sun. So it is the daytime that can allow us to see the sun. Otherwise, we cannot see the sun.
Okay, yeah.
And that's why the verse says, وَالنَّهَارِ إِذَا جَلَّهَا. When the daytime can make you easily observe the sun.
Okay. Now we let's move for a very short break and return back for a continuation of the explanation of this verse. And also we'll open up the questions to my dear guests.
Show is to really focus and gain a grasp of those things which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves, and those things which will gain for us the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and will make us amongst those who are beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Is there any evidence from the Quran that shows that those who repent are beloved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala?
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more happier with the repentance of his slave than you if you came across your camel after you lost it in a wide open land. The love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will enable us to reach into a status wherewith or in which we will taste the beauty of Iman.
We would like to be amongst those who love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and those whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves.
Indeed, you will see your Lord as you see this moon without having any harm in seeing the moon.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back. You're watching Quran and Science, and now we move to Abdurrahman for his questions.
If the atmosphere is responsible for using sun rays in order to illuminate Earth, is it also able to use the rays of other stars in some way or another?
Okay, I'd like to ask you to raise your voice a little bit.
Okay, if the atmosphere of Earth is responsible for using the sun rays in order to illuminate the Earth, is it also able to use the rays of other stars in some way or another?
The rays of other stars can only be used at night. So we can see some background illumination at night, which as a result of the cosmic particles coming not only from the sun, but also from other stars. But during daytime, the bulk of the energy that illuminates the daylight is coming from the sun.
So it's based on the distance.
Depends on the distance, of course. 150 million kilometers between us and the sun. The nearest sun, nearest star after the sun, 4.3 light years. Oh. And the light year is 9.5 million kilometers. You could imagine 9.5 million kilometers multiplied by 4.3. You could imagine the great distances.
Yes.
And there are stars that are far away from us, 24 billion light years. 1,000 million light years.
My question is about the second part of the verse. وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَغْشَاهَا. The word يَغْشَاهَا, what does it mean?
You see, الْغِشَاء in Arabic is a thin membrane. يَغْشَاء means to cover up. You see, the light covers up the sun from us, you see. We don't see it. Because first of all, as a result of the rotation of the Earth around its own axis, we can either face the sun or go away from the sun. So half of the Earth will be illuminated by the sun rays, and the other half will not get, reach any of the sun rays. So it will have double darkness. The darkness or the shadow of the lit part of the Earth and the darkness of the universe. So these combined together, of course, will cause us not to see the sun.
So you want to tell us, the professor, that and the out, away from the earth, it's all dark?
Absolutely dark.
Oh, so
pitch black.
Only the layers that you were telling me about.
No. All the universe.
No. Only the layers around this, around the earth that allows the ray.
One part of this
allows the reflection and reflections to
one see, part.
One part. Only 200 kilometers.
Right.
You see, after once you exceed these 200 kilometers, you see the sun dark. As a pale blue spot amidst pitch black area.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely black area.
Interesting.
And what makes the moon actually have some light, although the light is not...
You see, the moon is simply reflecting the sun rays. And the moon does not have an atmosphere. And because of that, it suffers lots of impacts of these meteorites. You see, the surface of the moon is all full of these holes. As a result of the meteoric impact. Because lacking an atmosphere, the atmosphere can either burn part of the meteor body or burn it completely or minimize its mass, you see? And that's why the impact would be less as on the Earth. But lacking the atmosphere allows the impact to be as strong as it could be, you see?
Yes.
And that's why most of the surface of the moon is covered by glassy material. And this glassy material results from the partial melting of the lunar rocks as a result of that impact. And what actually makes the moon illuminate at night, because it doesn't have an atmosphere, you see, it's the reflection of the sun rays towards us from this glassy layer on the surface of the moon.
Is there any change happening in the sun periodically or at the moon periodically? By the time, as years goes by?
Change like what?
Scientific changes.
Of course,
you see. Maybe the luminosity of the sun.
Everything in that universe is aging. Everything.
Yes.
Humans, animals, plants, planets, stars. Everything has got a beginning and an end.
Yes.
And of course, the moon is changing all the time. The Earth is changing all the time. The sun is changing all the time.
Okay, and the explanation of two scientific facts, one of them is in the morning you may see you may see the moon.
Yes.
Still there in the, lying in the sky.
Yes.
But what's the explanation of?
As I said, the moon revolves around the Earth spirally.
Yes.
So in that spiral movement, you will find that the moon will rise in a particular area. At midday.
Yes.
And you can see the moon at midday.
Or before sunset, or in the morning.
Or before sunset, yes. You see. But of course, as a result of this spiral rotation of the moon around the Earth.
Mm-hmm.
So it can be seen at different times in different places.
Yes, and what about Kusuf al-Shams and Kusuf al-Qamar? The part when the moon is between the sun and Earth, all the Earth between the moon and sun.
You see, if you have the moon between the sun and the Earth, as I said earlier, the lit half of the moon will be facing the sun, and the dark side of the moon will be facing the Earth. So we call this lunar eclipse.
Yes.
The darkness of the moon. Once the moon comes out of this straightforward lineation with the Earth and the sun, then the lunar month is born.
Mm-hmm.
The moon revolves until it comes, puts the Earth between the moon and the sun.
Yes.
You see, in that position, I usually get the full moon, because we get the light of the sun covering the full face of the moon, al-Badr, full moon. But sometimes you see the positioning of the Earth between the moon and the sun can conceal the sun from the Earth completely. Or partially, and that's why we can have what we call solar eclipse. A solar eclipse can be again a partial eclipse, an annular eclipse, or a full eclipse.
Yes.
And of course, this depends on where you are looking towards the sun when the moon is between the Earth and the sun.
So this is why sometimes you would see it from countries and other countries.
Oh yes. Yes. Again, due to this spiral movement, that's not in one plane, but is in more than one plane. Mm-hmm.
Yes, and in another verse, it was that we've mentioned in a previous episode. It was about Alhamdulillah, الذي خلق السماوات والأرض وجعل الظلمات والنور.
Yes.
Also in this verse, there is mentioning of the alternation of day and night. And we mentioned also that it reminds people when you're sleeping, it's just like dying. And when you're waking, it's like going back to the day of resurrection.
Yes. Yes.
Is there any connection or any bond between these two verses? Or does it indicate to the Muslim something?
Barakallahu feek. Well, you see, the first verse, Alhamdulillah, الذي خلق السماوات والأرض وجعل الظلمات والنور. Allah is showing His boundaries, that without this careful planning in the creation of the universe, you could have never had that bright daylight. Yes. You see? And the alternation of darkness and lit part of the day is an essential factor for the development of life.
Yes.
Plants, animals, and humans. In plants, as we mentioned in the last episode, the role of plant in daylight, in sunshine, is completely different from the role at night. Similarly with animals, with humans, you see, the human body needs darkness for its rest and for the development of certain hormones and certain enzymes to allow the body to rest. And it needs sunshine during the day to produce hormones of activation that will help the various systems of the body to be vivid and alert and ready to work.
Yeah. Yes.
So this alternation is again a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Alhamdulillah.
I do have an inquiry here.
Yes.
Can we apply this verse, وَالنَّهَارِ إِذَا جَلَّهَا, talking about the sun, all right, وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا يَغْشَاهَا, on different planets other than the earth?
Yes, definitely. Every planet has got day and night. Every planet, even the moon, every moon has got day and night. Exactly. And that's why all heavenly bodies are globular. All heavenly bodies belong to a star like our sun. All heavenly bodies, these satellites, revolve around their own axes and then run around the central part, the sun, you see. So they all have day and night.
But it's different, like the shortness of the day.
It varies, of course.
It varies
greatly. Yeah, you see. Yes, see. The closer you are to the sun, the shorter the period. The farther away from the sun, the longer the period. You see.
Okay. Any further questions?
Mentioning the moon and the lunar revolution, is it really possible that we have a one-day difference between two adjacent countries?
You see, actually, the difference is due to ignorance. It's not due to... This is a universal event. It's not limited to a particular area on the surface of the globe. You see, if we have one single Islamic state that governs the whole Muslims all over the world, we will fast exactly the same day and will break fasting on exactly the same day. Because once the moon has been seen, the lunar month is born.
For all the world.
For the whole world, you see. Mm-hmm. We only have the local time differences, you see. And the local time differences do not exceed 12 hours between the farthest points of the globe, plus or minus. So you use the time differences, you see. So we can have the sunset here, 8 hours for America, for example, you see. I can use that difference. But the moon, once it has been seen, the lunar month is born and becomes obligatory on all Muslims to start their fasting. But this birth of the moon has to be after the sunset. It cannot be before the sunset because, as I said earlier, the day of the Muslim starts with sunset and the morning starts with the early hours of Fajr.
Why don't we have a sort of an association or an entity that organizes fasting for the entire Muslims in the
pray
world?
For the unity of the Muslim Ummah, and then this will happen, inshallah.
Is it something difficult to implement?
It's not difficult, you see.
I mean, if one country sees the moon, and then
see,
and the that, point, and we consider this
definitely.
For all.
Wallah, it's a shame that we fast on different days and break fasting on different days. It's really for adjacent countries.
Hajj times is
Hajj
is
time
the same.
We have to follow.
Everything is the same. It should be. It should
have
be
to follow Saudi. Yes. The Hajj is there.
Yes.
But I'm talking about Ramadan and Eid al-Fitr, you see. Yes. Wallahi, akhi, it's a shame that we differ on that point. And we know that this is a universal event. If the month is born, if the moon is born, lunar, new moon is born, the month is born. We have to begin that. And inshallah, if we become united again in one simple country as we used to be in the past, we will fast on the same day and break fasting on the same day, inshallah.
So let's pray for that. And we thank you very much for being here with us. It was a pleasure to have you, Professor Zahrul Nagar. And I also love to thank Abdurrahman Ismail and Mustafa Ismail for being here with us. Thank you very much. And my dear brothers and sisters, we come to the end of this episode of Quran and Science, and see you in the next episode. Until then, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
There is a river in southern Africa that slowly winds its way through a wild wilderness. A wide open region with a diversity of habitats, where the inhabitants are as impressive and powerful as the river itself.